Vodka martini. Shaken. Not stirred. James Bond. Double O. 7. At your service. Welcome back, everyone. Matt the Mad here. So, after 20 years, we finally got a new James Bond movie. No, not really 20 years. But not that far off. Almost 6 years since the last James Bond movie, Spectre, came out November 2015. Then, No Time to Die was originally supposed to come out November 2019. They pushed that back to February 2020. And then they pushed it again to April 2020, and then COVID, and then they pushed it to the fall of 2020, and at that time when things still didn't look that good, they moved it almost a whole year later to now October 8th, 2021, mind you. So here we are. No Time to Die, the final Daniel Craig Bond movie. This is his 5th outing and final outing as Bond. I personally think Daniel Craig is the best Bond ever. I have seen all of the Bond movies and I can finally say Daniel Craig is the best. He brings the charm, he brings the action, he has someone who you don't want to ever fuck with. Not many of the James Bonds can say, that guy can really beat the shit out of you if he wanted to. But Daniel Craig is one of those people. Plus, he brings that vulnerability we've seen in, like, Casino Royale. He has a sense of humor. I mean, he, to me, is me, James Bond. He can be vulnerable. He's the best. Casino Royale, the first Daniel Craig Bond film, it's still my favorite James Bond movie. That year, in 2006, it was either my two favorite movies came down to Casino Royale or The Departed. I actually had the Casino Royale poster hanging in my dorm room from freshman year on. So, needless to say, I was never a huge James Bond fan growing up. My brother had the N64 GoldenEye game, and he had people come over and do tournaments around the time that GoldenEye, the first Brosnan film, was released. And we watched a few of the James Bond movies then, like the first Brosnan movies, some of the Roger Moore ones, like Moonraker. But I never saw any of the Sean Connery, Timothy Dalton, the one George Lazenby film. And the only Bond film that I ever owned prior to 2020 were the Daniel Craig Bond films. I have added to my library of movies, let's just say that. But I have seen all the Bond films. I think during the pandemic, there was when you had nothing to do, well, I said, you know what, instead of mid-watching Netflix, they're doing another Harry Potter marathon. You know what, I've never seen all the Bond movies. This is a perfect opportunity to sit down and watch the Bond movies. I got nothing else going on, collecting unemployment money like crazy. So, you know, I feel like one of the Bond villains, just getting rich, doing nothing. So I watched the Bond films, and now, here we are, at number 25 in the Bond franchise, Daniel Craig's 5th and last outing, and let's get into it, No Time to Die. You know, when I said that to my mother, you know, before the pandemic began, she said, Matt, if you get this coronavirus, you're going to die. I said, Mother, I'm not going to die. Yes, you will. You only have one lung. You're going to die. I said, Mother, I don't got no time to die, okay? No time to die. I ain't dying. Here I am. Do I look dead? I don't think so. Maybe close to it in terms of the weight loss, but in terms of everything else, he ain't dead. You'll know when he's dead, or will you? No. Anyway, no time to die. Let's start off with the positive of the force. Daniel Craig, I would actually say between this movie and Casino Royale, he gives his best performance. Once again here, he brings the action, the grittiness. He's romantic with his love interest, Madeline Swan, that's from the last movie, Spectre, played by Lea Seydoux. I'll get to her in a minute. He's once again vulnerable in this movie. He shows a lot more vulnerability in this film, like he did in Casino Royale, especially in those eyes. And once again, he gives another great performance. I mean, there's not that many Bond actors that have finished their final film and gone out on a high note, like Daniel Craig has gone out on a high note in this movie. Like that, he's the best Bond I think has ever been in the Bond franchise. And let me tell you, some people might have said this when Sean Connery went bye-bye. Whatever actor plays the next Bond, James Bond, they have a huge shoes to fill. Because he's one of the best. He's not one of the best. He is the best. Next we got Lea Seydoux coming back as Madeline Swan, James Bond's love interest in the last movie. She's a lot better here than she was in the first Inspector. I think mainly because the writer that gave her more complexity, more to do. She's very good in this movie. In fact, I know there's a lot of you are like, why would he hook up with that girl or whatever? And after watching this movie, I go, you know what? I believe that Bond would stop going on missions and stop, you know, being a spy in order to finally settle down and meet with this girl. Almost like in Casino Royale with Vespa, Evergreen's character. You bought it even though he was just starting out as a spy. You know what? When the girl was like, you know what? We're done. He said, I'm done being James Bond. I'm going to go live my life with this woman. You believe it again in this one. And I like how in the Daniel Craig era of Bond, after Casino Royale, he didn't really hook up with any women. Really. Quantum of Solace, there's really not a Bond girl in the overall quotation of what a Bond girl is. And Skyfall, no Bond girl at all. I like them halfway through Spectre until he finally hooked up with Madeline Swan. So, Lea Seydoux is very good in this one. She brings a lot of emotion to it. She is sometimes being a badass in the role. She has actually a lot better chemistry with Daniel Craig this time around. We get into a little bit more of her backstory, and it's fascinating. So, once again, one of the improvements over the last movie, and it's a very good improvement. Next up, we got Ana de Armas. She comes in. Now, let me say one thing. If you're going to this movie wanting to watch Ana de Armas, she's only in one sequence, not one scene, an entire sequence in Cuba. And let me tell you, she is almost the standout of this movie. If it wasn't for Daniel Craig, she's only in one sequence, but oh my god, I could watch an entire movie of her as a spy. She is excellent. This movie is dark. It's very emotional. And when she comes on screen in the whole sequence in Cuba, it's like a Yeah, man, sorry, can't speak today. A breath of fresh air. I mean, it's energetic, it's, you're laughing, you're cheering, you're almost like you just got a boost of adrenaline. It's just rapid fire, and it's action-packed, and she does an amazing job, and it's so disappointing she's only in that one sequence. Because you're like, can't Bond and her just team up for the rest of the movie? Because that would be amazing. I don't know if they're ever going to bring her character back in future Bond movies. I hope so. Because she is amazing. And like I said, she's only in one sequence. And she practically steals the entire movie in just one sequence. I really like that. Next, Rami Malek. Rami Malek plays the villain, Safe Sassen. That's how you say it. You know, well, this is what I'll say about Rami Malek. The character is underwritten, but the performance is good. Now, I'm not saying he's no Lachif, Mads Mikkelsen in Casino Royale. He's no Raul Silva, Jeremy, Javier Bardem in Skyfall. But I do think he was better than Dominic Green in Quantum of Solace, or even Christoph Waltz as Blofeld in Spectre. Rami Malek, here's the interesting thing about Rami Malek. Just him in general, he comes off creepy. If you've seen any other movie or TV, he comes off a little creepy sometimes. I don't know if it's just the look or his voice, but putting those together, he always comes off a little creepy to me. And now playing this Bond villain in a much darker Bond film, especially in the opening prologue, it works. Right? And the character is underwritten a lot. You really don't know what his overall motivation is. In fact, by the end of the movie, you're like, so what is his overall, what was his overall plan? I don't know. There's a lot of critics that have said the same thing, like, I don't know. I have no clue. But when he's on screen, he brings this creepy vibe to him that works for a Bond villain. Especially in one sequence I won't spoil, because it would be a major spoiler. But he works in the role. I wish it was written better and more going on with him. Because he really doesn't show up other than the prologue. I would say he probably doesn't show up almost over an hour later into the movie. So, or even more than that. So, Rami Malek does a fine job. Now, the action. Once again, when you go into a Bond movie, you expect action. That's what Bond is an action movie. Yeah, it has other things in it, that bring it all together. But when you go see a Bond movie, you go see for the action. That's why movies like Casino Royale and Skyfall, yeah, they have the character development, but they also have some really, really great action sequences. And this movie is no different. The opening before the title sequences go in the like normal Bond movies is great. I think they're in Italy. The car chase is excellent. It gets you in it. It gets you going. Then later on, like I said, the Cuba scene. I could have watched the whole movie in Cuba. And that entire sequence is amazing. It's fun. It's energetic. There's a lot of action. There's gunfights. There's just hand-to-hand combat. It's great. Music works. Then there's a scene in... Then there's another car chase... out in the... in Norway. And then they go into this forest. And it's foggy, all fog surrounding them. And once again, the sequence is another incredible sequence. You know, it's just... They're not, you know, they're not chasing anymore. They're, you know, Bond has to use this, you know, detective and spy work. And it's another amazing sequence. What's another one? And then, of course, the final act, the third act on the island that Safran is on. Once again, great sequence. There's a sequence in there with a long tracking shot of Bond going up this, like, staircase. And the, other than the action, if you just go see this movie for action alone, you will not be disappointed at all. It's definitely the best action movie of the year. So, there's that. The score, Hans Zimmer, he will know who. If you don't know who Hans Zimmer is, why are you watching me? I mean, well, first of all, if you don't know who Hans Zimmer is, clearly, you've never seen any of the Batman films, the Christopher Nolan Batman films, because the composer of all the Batman movies, the Nolan movies, is Hans Zimmer. And there are sequences in this movie. One of them is where we see Blofeld, Christoph Waltz returns. That's in the trailer, so it's not a spoiler. The way the score in that sequence when Blofeld is coming up to Bond is great. It's intense and gets you kind of like on the edge of your seat, and it's a great composition or composed score in that sequence. Another one is in the final act, in the third act, on the island, you know, time is running out for Bond to do something, and this score just kicks in, and I'll admit, and I'm not the only one that said this, it had a little bit of the Dark Knight score in it, then you went near, and like in the Dark Knight when things are racketing up, and they're under a time constraint, and the clock is ticking, I heard a little bit of the Dark Knight score in there. I don't know if it's Hans Zimmer being the same composer, but it worked. I mean, Hans Zimmer is one of the best composers out there, and here he finally does a James Bond movie, and it is a great score. Cinematography, it looks great, like I said. The opening in Norway in the snow is excellent. The shots on the island, and the look of that in Cuba, in the nightclub, beautifully shot. Like, some of the long tracking shots in the movie are great. So the cinematography is excellent. I wouldn't say it's not as good as Skyfall. Skyfall is still the best shot James Bond movie because of Roger Deakins. What is another great looking Bond movie? Then we get into the pacing. This movie is almost 3 hours long, and at least for me, it doesn't feel like it. In fact, this movie is the same length as The Dark Knight Rises, which was almost 3 hours also. And I would say to you, I would sit down and watch this movie, No Time to Die, before I sat down and watched The Dark Knight Rises. Because The Dark Knight Rises in the second half, in the second act in that movie, it slows down, like, considerably, like a complete halt. And it really does make you feel almost that 3 hour runtime in The Dark Knight Rises. Where here, because there is a lot of action throughout the movie, and there's character moments, and you're invested a lot more in the character, the pacing just moves really well. So I'm personally, and like I said, this is the longest James Bond movie in the entire franchise. The last Bond movie, Spectre, was the longest at the time, and now No Time to Die is the longest. Bold decisions. We heard rumors that this movie takes a lot of swings. This movie is going to be the boldest James Bond movie you will have ever seen. And I know there are people like, yeah, whatever. It's a James Bond movie. What are you going to do that's so different from the other Bond films? Well, let me tell you. I'm not going to spoil anything, but they take some risks. Major risks. And I will say, I like them. I like them a lot. Right, mainly because I know this Bond, Daniel Craig, James Bond, has a more mature aspect about him than I've seen in other Bond movies and other actors playing Bond. And what we saw like in Casino Royale and like Skyfall, the maturity and the growth in his character, I believe the decision that they went with in this movie worked. And that's all I'll say. They work. Once again, this is the final Daniel Craig Bond film. And I think they ended it on a great note. I think this really, out of every actor that has played Bond in their final movie, from Sean Connery to Roger Moore to Pierce Brosnan, at least the one that had more than two films, this is the only one that has an actual great send-off, ending, for an actor that has played Bond. And not only that, but I think almost everyone can say, not only is this a great send-off for Daniel Craig's Bond, for the character, but as a movie, as the final movie for him, this is the best Bond film for an actor hanging up the role. Die Another Day for Pierce Brosnan. I have fun with that movie, but it's not good. Roger Moore's final movie with, A View to a Kill, with Christopher Walken as the bad guy. Horrible. What else? Sean Connery. In the last two movies that Sean Connery did, you can clearly tell he was just doing it for a paycheck. And the movies weren't that. And the movie wasn't good. So this is the first Bond movie that is actually good, or very good, for a final send-off for an actor. So, what else? Billy Magnussen. Billy Magnussen is a character in the movie, and he does an excellent job. I was almost hoping that there was going to be a twist in this movie, that Billy Magnussen was going to end up being, well, I won't say that, but he doesn't actually, you might remember him from Aladdin. He was in that movie Game Night with Jason Bateman and Rachel McAdams. But he is very good in this movie. Like, I was watching him going, why haven't we seen that side of you in other roles? So I thought he did a great job. I think a lot of people have also said about the Daniel Craig Bond films, they feel like all one movie, like Casino Royale, then Quantum of Solace was a direct sequel to Casino Royale. It literally opened 2 seconds after Casino Royale ended. Skyfall is kind of its own movie, but then Spectre somehow tied the first three movies together. And of course, this movie really is a sequel to Spectre, but also wrapping up everything in the Craig months. You can even go back to something in the Casino Royale with Vesma, Eva Green's character. And I like that. I think that's the only thing about these Bond movies that's different from all the other Bond movies is that not only is this a more grounded, grittier Bond, and more realistic Bond, but they also tie all the movies together. And I think, you know, when No Time to Die comes out, it'll be really fun and interesting to just binge watch all five movies and maybe pick up on stuff that you didn't notice before, but now that you watch them all together, you'll be able to pick up on stuff and just see the through line in the entire five movie series, I guess if you will. Cary Fukunaga. Cary Fukunaga. A lot of people should be like, huh? This is the first American director to do a Bond film. Cary Fukunaga is the guy. Well, let me just say this. When they said that Cary Fukunaga was going to be directing this Bond film, I already said, oh. Oh. This is going to be a dark Bond movie. This is going to be a dark Bond film. Because I'm like, if the guy who did True Detective Season 1 with Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson, they got that guy to do this. This is the same guy that was originally supposed to direct the It Chapter 1 movie, the It movie, Pennywise the Clown. But his, now, get this, people. Cary Fukunaga's script was darker than the Stephen King novel. Wrap your head around that. The script that Cary Fukunaga wrote was even darker than the Stephen King novel. Okay? So, when they said that Cary Fukunaga is directing this movie, I went, okay. Now, the Daniel Craig movies have had a dark tone to them and feel to them than other Bond movies. I think most people would agree with that the Daniel Craig Bond films are darker, grittier Bond movies than we've ever seen before. And now you're adding a director that is known for dark material and tone and characters. Oh boy. And let me tell you, in the opening of the movie, you definitely feel right off the bat Cary Fukunaga's stamp on the movie. Like you say, if you've seen True Detective Season 1, you definitely feel Cary Fukunaga's footprint, handprint, whatever you want to call it, right on the movie. And then, like I said, throughout the movie, a lot of dark moments. Like I said, Remy Malek, the creepy character. So I even got those True Detective vibes there. He makes a lot of bold decisions, like that, once again, that long tracking shot during a gunfight. Just like in True Detective Season 1, when we had that long tracking shot in whatever episode 7 or 6 was the whole shootout. So he brought that back. I think this is a very, very well directed Bond film. And you definitely see the director's stamp on it. And I hope he does another Bond film. You know? Martin Campbell did GoldenEye and Casino Royale. Sam Mendes did Skyfall and Spectre. I hope Cary Fukunaga does another film. Okay, what else? Oh yeah, sound design. Forgot about sound. Sound design in this movie is great. The way there's a scene that a bomb goes off, and you can tell that Bond can't hear, like it's all muffled, and the sound design in those moments, I thought, I have never heard it like that before, when it sounds like the most realistic after a bomb going off right in front of somebody, and then the aftermath of that. Feels a lot more realistic than in other films I've seen. So the sound design is excellent in this movie. And the final positive I have with this is the supporting cast. I mean, not only Lea Seydoux, Rami Malek, Ana de Armas, but then you got your regulars like M, Moneypenny, Q, I said Blofeld has a scene. That's great. Billy Magnuson has another, is great. One of Sasha's henchmen we see throughout the movie, he has like one eye, and he has like a buzz, or like a, well, like a, almost like my hair, but even less hair on the side, and just on the top. No, that was not a GoldenEye reference. On the top. No, the supporting cast is great in this movie. The director and the writers found a way to give everybody a moment. And not just, oh, here's your moment, but really, you know, flesh them out a little bit. Go deeper if there's characters we've seen in, like, Spectre with Madeline Swann or Blofeld. And then letting you get like Billy Magnuson and this other henchman that are really good throughout the movie. And like I said, Ana de Armas has that great sequence that literally seals the movie. Then you got Lashana Lynch as the new 007 showing up and throughout the movie. And her back and forth with Bond and their overall story arc is great. You also got Jeffrey Wright coming back from Casino Royale and Quantum of Solace. Like I said, wrapping up, having these Bond films feel like one giant story, having Felix Leiter, Jeffrey Wright back. In the sequence he's in, they're great. Him and Bond are like buddies, best friends. You know, haven't seen each other in a while. Like old times, it's great. So I like how the director and the writers found a way in this movie with so many characters, to give them all their moment, but also all of them have a good beginning and ending. You know what I mean? They, nothing's left off the table. Nothing's just open-ended at the end. I really like that. I thought that was another great way to end this Daniel Craig Bond series. Now to the negatives. I really don't have that many. But first one is the Bond villain. I think he's underwritten. We never really know what his overall plan is. We really don't. So I think that needed a little bit more work. You know, I think that's one thing about the Daniel Craig movie that we can all agree on. That other than for Le Chiffre and Casino Royale and Raul Silva and Skyfall, the other villains in like Quantum and Spectre and now No Time to Die are underwhelming. So I think that would probably be the biggest takeaway from the Bond or the Daniel Craig era of Bond. The villains aren't that memorable other than two. And that's one. The other one wanted more Ana de Armas. Like I said, she was great in the Cuba sequence. I wish they had more of her. My only other negative is a spoiler, and I won't spoil it, but there is a character that the Bond villain says, "You don't want to come with me? Okay. Go. Go away. Go anywhere. Go. Leave my sight." And I can't spoil it, but I'm like, huh? And then somehow this character finds Bond and Madeline Swan, and I'm like, how did that character find them on this giant island filled with very hazardous material everywhere? It's even worse when you realize the character, you really go, are we missing a scene in the middle here? Because A did not go to B, A to C, where's B? Where's B? We're missing B. We got A, we got C. Where's B? That is really my only negatives. Maybe if I watch the movie again, I'll, find more. But I would really give this movie probably a 4.8 or 4.9 out of 5. I think it's a great send-off from Daniel Craig. It wraps up his era of Bond perfectly, going 15 years now. I still remember being a junior in high school when Casino Royale came out, standing in line at the Regal at North Point, United Artists, and waiting in line. I mean, back then they didn't have assigned seating. We got our tickets early, but we still had to wait in line to get in there and find a great seat, a perfect seat. And here we are now, 15 years later. During that time, I was in the middle of editing my first football film for Milton High School. Before, everything changed. Before I became the film guy at Milton. So it was very interesting on the journey of just thinking when Daniel Craig began. I was just finishing up my first semester junior year. And now here I am, about to turn 32 in 3 days. Just 3 days. Wow. That's the other thing. Daniel Craig has actually been now the longest running Bond in the franchise. Not in terms of movies, but in terms of from the time he started in 2006. Till now, 2021, he's now been the longest actor to be playing Bond. Actively playing Bond. So, anyway, Matt the Mad here. Once again, the name, Bond. James Bond.